Hey everyone, this lesson is on amebiasis, or otherwise known as intestinal amebiasis. So in this lesson, we're going to talk about specifically an infection with Entamoeba histolytica. We're also going to talk about how we can get infected with this type of amoeba, what is the pathogenesis, how this amoeba can cause the signs and symptoms that it does. We're also going to talk about those signs and symptoms, and we're also going to talk about how we can treat it. So intestinal amebiasis is an invasive intestinal infection with amoeba of the genus Entamoeba. So Entamoeba, you can remember the word entamoeba by it's the suffix amoeba, so that's easy. And then we can think of ent, so ent in intestinal. So that's how we can remember this type of genus of amoeba. Now, it's estimated that about 50 million individuals are infected worldwide annually with this type of infection. And there are actually four different types of amoeba species that can cause intestinal amoebiasis. These include Entamoeba histolytica, Entamoeba dispar, Entamoeba moshkovsky, and Entamoeba bangladeshi. And again, we're going to specifically talk about Entamoeba histolytica because this is the most common cause of intestinal amebiasis. So how do we get infected with this amoeba? Well, there's a cyst stage of infection. That's the infective stage. And then there's also the trophozoite stage, which is the stage of the amoeba that actually causes the invasive disease. So we get an infection from ingestion of the amoebic cysts. So the amoeba during their cyst stage, that is the infective stage. We can get this from contaminated water or food. We can also get it from fecal oral route as well. So if an individual has an infection with Entamoeba histolytica, they will actually release mature cysts in their feces. And then if another individual comes along and actually ingests contaminated food or water that has been contaminated with these cysts, they're going to get infected themselves. So surprisingly, these cysts can actually survive in the environment for weeks to months, so they're very resilient. And there are several stages of infection. So again, the cysts are the infective stage. They are what we ingest from the environment. And when these cysts pass through the stomach, they will transform into trophozoite in the small intestine. This is what is the cause of the invasive disease. So the trophozoites themselves will invade into the mucosa of large intestine. So they pass through all the small intestine, they make it to the large intestine, and then they start to wreak havoc. So they start to cause damage to the tissue, causing increased secretions and eventual bloody diarrhea. So they basically burrow into the mucosa of the large intestine. This causes damage to those tissues. The tissues begin to become inflamed and edematous, causing increased secretions, and then you're going to get blood as a result of all that damage. So what does the Entamoeba histolytica specifically do to cause this pathogenic scenario? Well, Entamoeba histolytica, for one, they secrete proteinases that destroy proteins. So they will secrete these enzymes, proteinases, that destroy proteins of the host. So they can go in, release these proteinases, and can actually destroy proteins in the large intestinal mucosa. Another thing they can do is they can destroy intestinal cells through a direct contact mechanism. So they can get against the cells, and they can actually destroy the cells through direct contact. They can also form what we call an amoeba pore, which forms pores in lipid bilayers of infected cells. This will basically lyse the cells and to cause them to become injured and destroyed. And another pathogenic mechanism by which Entamoeba histolytica can cause tissue damage is through disrupting tight junction proteins that eventually result in increased intestinal permeability. So with all these mechanisms, they can lead to destruction of intestinal tissue, leading to a bloody diarrhea, and also increased secretions, increased intestinal permeability. So they can do a lot of damage. So what are some of the clinical features of intestinal amoebiasis? We already talked about several. So some of the other ones can include the following. You can actually have an asymptomatic picture. So if you have a very good immune system, if you're exposed to these amoeba, you might not even have these symptoms if you're able to clear the infection. The other one is amoebic dysentery. So we've talked about this in length. The dysentery, again, involves abdominal pain and colitis. They can get bloody diarrhea from this. And again, the bloody diarrhea is due to local tissue damage and destruction. And in addition to amoebic dysentery, you may also get amoebic abscesses. And these abscesses will commonly occur in the liver. So here's an image, a CT scan of amoebic abscesses within the liver. And these are due to hematologic spread. So if you get an infection in your GI system, they can actually spread hematologically to the liver and set up shop there. And you're going to get hepatomegaly, right upper quadrant pain, weight loss, and fever. And these abscesses can also occur in other sites, less commonly than the liver, but you can also get them in the lungs and the brain. So this can be very significant. So again, these abscesses are most common in the liver, but can also occur in the lungs and the brain. So these are the three clinical scenarios with an infection of Entamoeba histolytica. One, you may be completely asymptomatic. If you have a very good immune system, you may be able to clear this infection with no issues. The second, you might have amoebic dysentery. So you might have abdominal pain, colitis, you may have bloody diarrhea due to that tissue damage we talked about before. And the third, you may get these amoebic abscesses. And these abscesses most commonly occur in the liver, but can also occur in the lungs and the brain. So how do we remember the clinical features of intestinal amebiasis? Well, we can think about the species Entamoeba histolytica. So Entamoeba, you can think of ent for intestinal, so that might clue you into the dysentery. And you can think of histolytica, lytic, that component of the word lytic. Lytic means destruction. So you can think of lytic as destroying abdominal tissue. So that's, you can think of that in relation to the bloody diarrhea. Or another way to remember these clinical features is the mnemonic Amy ordered blood labs. So Amy, spelled A-M-E, so that'll clue you into amoeba, ordered blood labs. Blood, this will help you remember bloody diarrhea, and labs, L for liver, and abs for abscess. So you can just think of maybe a physician whose name is Amy, she's ordering blood labs, and that may help you remember that amoeba or Entamoeba histolytica cause bloody diarrhea and L for liver and abs for abscess. So they cause bloody diarrhea and liver abscess. So hopefully that helps you remember some of the clinical features of amebiasis. So how do we make the diagnosis and how do we treat intestinal amebiasis? So investigations and diagnosis include the following. So we can do serology. We can look for antibodies against Entamoeba histolytica. We can do antigen testing. We can do stool sampling, looking for those trophozoites we talked about before. And we may need to do a biopsy of the colon. Because these amoeba can burrow into the intestinal mucosa, you might have to actually take a piece of the colon to actually look at it under a microscope to see these organisms. So once you've made the diagnosis, how do you treat it? So treatment involves the use of metronidazole. So if we've got intestinal amoebiasis, just the GI symptoms of amoeba infection, we can use metronidazole to help clear that infection. If we have, you know, more of an invasive picture, more systemic illness, perhaps cysts, perhaps more an invasive disease, we might have to use idoquinol or paromycin. So again, these are for cysts and for invasive disease. So these can be effective treatments for amoebiasis. So if you want to learn more about infectious diseases, please check out my infectious disease playlist. And if you haven't already, please consider liking, subscribing, and clicking the notification bell to help support the channel. And as always, thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you next time.